Hi, everybody. We are here to talk about unboring Zoom breakout rooms. And this is designed to be a super fast blast. So I'm actually going to have you in and out of here within 15 minutes, maybe even less. Part of the reason we're going to be able to move that quickly is that if you go to the chat, you will see a link to the slide deck that I'm going to share. And that's really the resource that I am showing you. So what I really want to do is show you how to use that resource. And we're going to go from there. So I'm going to open up my deck. All right. So I assume you are seeing my screen now and not in presentation mode. You're actually seeing the whole thing. And that's because I want to show you how this slide deck works. So you have already opened the slide deck. We're gonna read through the slides quickly together, but I wanna show you that if you like an idea on a slide, down below in the Google slide decks, there are note sections. So that's where you're gonna find more info on the ideas that you're interested in. So we're gonna jump right in and I'll show you how it works. So the first slide is about how to use icebreakers. So what we're talking about now is not just Zoom, but Zoom breakout rooms. If you don't know how to set up Zoom breakout rooms, you can put in a ticket with IT and they can teach you how to do that. It's about a 5-minute learning curve if you know how to use Zoom. Although there are some tricky things about students sorting themselves into Zoom rooms. And that's the kind of thing the CoLab can also walk you through if you're using breakout rooms, but you have some questions. So these are about how to make your breakout rooms less boring so that you don't just go to them and say, okay, here's a question, everybody talk about it, then we'll come back to the larger group. So the first idea comes from two people, Guevara and Andrew Zubiri. You will see these names sometimes look funny because they are their usernames on Twitter, which is where most of these great ideas came from. What I want to show you is down in the notes section, this is where you'll find the links to the original tweets where people are talking about their brilliant ideas. So that if you hear of an idea that you like, but you don't really understand exactly how to set it up, go and look at the original tweet. Whether you have a Twitter account or not, these will open for you. And a lot of times they have more information. So you'll see one example of an icebreaker that's really simple is when you go into the breakout rooms, have them have to do one fun thing before they start, which can determine who will share first. So that can be anything from the furthest place that you visited before quarantine, any kind of icebreaker like that. But you'll see Andrew has a more complex thing. He actually created a bingo style icebreaker using breakout rooms and Google Sheets. If you wanted to run that, what you would do is you'd go down to the notes section and you'll see a link called Andrew's Bingo Game. And that's going to give you all the information on his bingo game. So the first suggestion for unboring breakout rooms is assign a fun icebreaker. The second and absolutely most popular crowdsourced idea on unboring breakout rooms was shared docs. Most people, if you look down at the notes section, you will see just the large number of people who are using this as an idea. What this means is that when you send people into the breakout rooms, you open a Google Doc or some other shared document like a Padlet or an Etherpad or a Jamboard. If you don't know what these are, you can look through those notes there and find different ways. And people do all sorts of different things, but a lot of times they'll just have sections like group one, group two, group three. And people will take notes in those different sections. It makes some accountability so that people don't just go silent in the breakout rooms and gives you an artifact to look at later. Also, you can watch that document emerge in real time when the breakout groups are going on. So it might tell you if one group is having some challenges. So you can actually pop into the breakout rooms, which Zoom allows you to do, right? You can go around and visit those. A related idea is shared slide decks. So a lot of people will make a slide deck just like you're seeing right here. This is my Google slide deck. If you've just used PowerPoint in the past, Google slide decks are the same thing except they're online. So they allow everybody, like if I had the settings shared to edit on this, you could all jump into this slide deck and edit. So a lot of times in breakout rooms, people make slides for each group, and they ask each group to design a slide so that when you come back, you sort of have a presentation that will allow you to go through it and people can talk. The ideas are also kind of fun and quirky. So lots of people are using music in their breakout rooms. Some people are appointing DJs for specific breakout rooms, and their only job is to create a soundtrack as the rest of the group discusses. A lot of times people will ask their groups to create or to choose one theme song that's related to the content or the issue. So people will search around for different music, and you can use that in playback when you come back as a large group as a way of tipping off the conversation. So lots of people using music. A lot of people are also using music when the Zooms are starting. So the professor will come in and be DJing at the beginning of every class. And sometimes that music will have something to do with the content for the day. Another idea is using memes. After your group has discussed whatever content they're supposed to discuss, have them create one meme that they can share back as a way of talking about some of the things that their groups are working on. Whiteboards. Zoom has whiteboard capabilities built right in. They can use whiteboards in their breakout rooms. There's lots of different ideas for using whiteboards. In addition to the Zoom whiteboards, lots of people seem to be using Jamboards, which I've never used, but it's the shared Google version of a whiteboard. So you might want to explore Jamboards, because everybody was talking about how they love the Jamboards. But lots of people will have their breakout rooms create a whiteboard that they can then share back when they come to the full group. So that's different ways. You can put images on those whiteboards, you can draw on them, you can write on them, you can brainstorm text. Three, two, ones. So they do whatever content they're going to do asynchronously before they come to class. And their homework is to bring three things they learned, two interesting points, and one question. And then in the breakout rooms, they will discuss those questions that they brought. So that's really just about having the homework populate the questions that you will then use in the breakout rooms. Some folks are gamifying their breakout rooms. Maida Ali has a snakes and ladders game that you can use that is kind of fun. But even if you don't want to use that exact game, it might give you some ideas about how to gamify. Another really popular tweet that's been going around for the last couple weeks is that somebody made their breakout rooms into escape rooms. So in order to leave class, basically, you had to do a challenge in your breakout room. And if you could solve that challenge or puzzle, you could come back to the professor and essentially break yourself out of class. Don't forget that your content is linked to interesting things that are going on in the world. I swear it is. Whatever your content is, I swear it is linked to hot topics in the world. So lots of people are having good luck when instead of just discussing content, they're discussing the links between that content and current events in the world that might be a little bit controversial or interesting. This is the try then teach model. So the idea is that they go into their breakout rooms having to learn or think about something and design a small 5-minute lesson so that when they come back, their job is to teach the rest of the class about that thing. So this person here is a math professor, but there are, in working through a problem and explaining that problem, but you could really do that, I think, in any discipline. Here's a good suggestion, do real stuff. So the idea here is instead of creating, some kind of hoop jumping, try to work on an issue or problem that is real. So for example, design the method for a grant funded project, decide who to invite as a guest speaker and come up with a pitch for why, and then actually make that pitch, choose a guest speaker and invite them and see if they'll come in on Zoom, right? So the idea there is instead of working on abstract ideas, try to put them on an actual task that will have impact for them and their classmates. That of course is related to something we talk about a lot at Plymouth State, which is project-based learning. Lots of people are using group work for extended projects. So instead of one-off group works, They're trying to link them to ongoing projects, and they're finding that those groups are developing a pretty good rapport. Here's somebody, their public health class is working on creating voter registration or voter education materials on health issues. So when they go into the groups, they're actually working on those projects, which tends to get people engaged and actually moving. Remember, you do have some Zoom tools that could be useful. So a lot of people use the names. So if you go to the little dots around your name here, like if you go to your picture, you can go to the three little dots there and you can click on rename. You can do cool stuff with that. So that might, you know, right now it has my name, Robin DeRosa, but you can also call me group one, right? So these are different ways that people can assign themselves to groups, can answer questions actually even. They can change backgrounds to do things. You have annotation tools that you can use up in the Zoom toolbar. So if I put on a whiteboard, for example, people can use the annotate tools to jump on that whiteboard. So if you're not too familiar with all the little things in Zoom, play around with them and try to think outside of the box, right? We think about our names as being just a place for our names. It doesn't mean that's where your name has to go, right? Students can change that and you can link that to little activities that you're using with Zoom. I also don't want you to forget that you have other class-based activities that you've always done in your classes. So try to think about how you can use Zoom breakout groups with those. This example here, and again, I want to remind you, click on the tweet links below, you'll get more information, because I believe Katie's link to the silent seminar exercise is there. But this is about stuff you might have done in class where people write and then pass the paper to the next group, or they have newsprints up on the walls and they're rotating around writing things. Think about how you can use breakout groups to effectively do those kinds of classroom-based activities that you used to do before. Here is a class, actually, it's a medical case study class where they had to make little plays about the different case studies that they do. Obviously, she's saying it was cringeworthy and embarrassing, but that was part of what was fun about it, right? So if you send people in to create skits, they can quote unquote perform those when you come back. I'm not gonna read all this stuff, but BJ has some really interesting stuff about how to use reporters in your groups, because you always say report back later, but there are different ways to designate reporters. Lots of people are not just designating reporters, but they're also designating other roles in the class. So if one person's the reporter, another might be the recorder, another might be the researcher, another might be looking for images. So you can actually assign different roles. Somebody could be the questioner, somebody could be the facilitator. So think about the kinds of roles that you might use. A lot of people are using structured reporting. So instead of saying, come back and tell us what you did, they are actually creating either Google Forms or a Google Doc where you need to put in your takeaways from your group work into that reporting document. Other people are tweaking this to be more like an exit ticket. What's the key thing that you learned here? Kind of like a self-assessment or a self-reflection at the end of the breakout groups. The Enter Key is Lava comes from Doug Shaw. His link is down below there. He's taught a whole little class on Zoom hacks that is really popular. And basically this is like, come up with your takeaway from the breakout group, put it in the chat, but don't push enter yet. The Enter Key is Lava, don't touch it. And then when you announce it, everybody pushes enter at the same time so the chat populates. It's just a fun way to get everybody's ideas coming out at one time. And you can use the Enter Key as Lava for lots of different exercises in Zoom. General tips, most people said, please keep these breakout groups short. 10 minutes was about the max. Obviously that's different if you're doing project-based learning, but most people seem to suggest that it worked better when they didn't have dead time. Instructions in the chat are gonna be visible to them even when they go to the breakout rooms. So consider however you give the instructions, pasting a copy in the chat so they can always refer to it. Different people had different ideas about whether groups should be randomly generated or set up. But obviously, if you do consider setting them up, then you might want to extend that for a couple of weeks so that they have a chance to name their group, create a theme song for themselves, you know, anything to build that rapport. Most people said groups of four worked best. It obviously depends on what you're doing. There's actually some research that suggests four is the sweet spot. I think that research is linked down below there. Broadcast message reminders. You can send messages into those breakout groups. And most people suggest telling your students to view their group in gallery mode so they can really get a sense of all people talking at one time. Specific to good stuff for Zoom breakouts, I have put what I think are the absolute best things for you to check out. I'm not going to go through all of these, but liberating structures is a different way to organize basically running of groups. So it gives you different models for group work. And then the active learning while physically distancing is just a crowdsourced Google Doc of a whole bunch of active learning things. That's what I've got for you today. Anything that you're interested in here, remember to go down to those tweets and you will get more information about the particulars of how it's done. I'm going to stop recording and then we can chat for a couple minutes, or I can just let you go because that's the end of our Fast Blast.